Mr. President, on Tuesday of this week, the Senate Finance Committee had a very important hearing on the skyrocketing costs of prescription drugs, something the presiding officer knows a lot about. In 2017, a study found that more than half of Americans regularly take some form of prescription medication. Modern medicine has made living with chronic health conditions that would have once been debilitating or fatal, like diabetes, high blood pressure, or asthma, modern medicine have made living with those conditions manageable. So that's a blessing for which we are all grateful. But I know at the same time many of my constituents and many Americans struggle to buy prescription drugs to treat common health problems, not because they aren't widely available, but because they simply are unaffordable. For many higher-cost brand-name drugs, generic alternatives are available at a lower price. For example, I happen to take a drug called Lipitor, which previously was covered by a patent, and as a result of that patent, the cost of the drug was higher because the producer of the drug had a monopoly. And we grant that monopoly for a period of time, I believe it's 12 years, in order for them to recoup their research and investment dollar. And unfortunately, many of these efforts to come up with life-saving drugs are unsuccessful. And so we have to figure in, in order to encourage innovation and life-saving discoveries, we have to find a way to allow these drug companies to recover their sunk costs and to make a profit. But generic drugs have been a lifesaver for many people. That same Lipitor that I take, now it's off of patent, is available for just a few dollars for a 30-day supply. That's just one example. One study found that 93% of generic prescriptions are filled at $20 or less, with the average cost being just more than a little over $6. But for many drugs, there are no low-cost alternatives, and people are increasingly struggling to cover the rising costs of their medication. We had one witness from Indiana, Kathy Sego, who I think speaks for a lot of parents who have children suffering from diabetes needing insulin. And her story, I think, was emblematic of that problem across the country. But just in her case, she is a wife, a mother of two, and a choir teacher. Her son, Hunter, is one of the more than 30 million Americans who suffers from diabetes, and he relies on insulin to manage his blood sugar. Kathy told us that when Hunter, her son, started college, he began to go to the pharmacy to pick up his insulin prescription himself. That's when he discovered that it cost $1,700 a month. That's even with health insurance. The copay, the part they were responsible for and had been paying for Hunter, unbeknownst to him, is $1,700 a month. Kathy assured him that unfortunately that cost was correct. $1,700 only covers a one-month supply. Over the next few weeks, their family began to notice a change in their son, and Hunter. He was losing weight, falling behind in school, and was depressed, a far cry from what she said was his normally positive and energetic self. Unbeknownst to his parents, Hunter had only purchased one vial of insulin when he needed four, and he began rationing his supply of the drug. To try to counterbalance that, he began skipping meals, which is dangerous for a diabetic to do, let alone an incredibly active college football player like him. Fortunately, in time, his family realized what had happened and they intervened, avoiding what could have been fatal consequences. But her family still battles with the expense of this insulin. Kathy said she worries about what happens when Hunter graduates from college, noting that his life choices are contingent upon his ability to pay for the medicine he needs to keep him alive. She wondered at our hearing, can he afford an apartment, utility bills, can he repay his student loans? Hunter, she said, needs insulin to live, but should that need for insulin keep him from living? Well, about 1.5 million Americans have type 1 diabetes like Hunter, where their body produces no insulin to deal with the blood sugar. But as I mentioned earlier, 30 million Americans, according to the Center for Disease Control, have diabetes. And about 3 million of those 30 million are in my state of Texas. 3 million Texans have diabetes, for which insulin is a required treatment. And while we know that it's common to see higher drug prices for new drugs that have recently completed a costly research and development phase, that's not the case for insulin, which has been around for nearly a century and is a type of biologic drug which is generally more expensive to produce. So I hope that Kathy's and Hunter's story, which could be told millions of times by other families across the country, impels us to investigate the causes for these unreasonable costs for some of these prescription drugs. And I hope we find a solution. I'm confident we will if we try hard enough, that will allow families like Kathy's to live without the burden of wondering how to pay for their health care costs, particularly when it comes to prescription drugs. At Tuesday's hearing, I also questioned our witnesses about a phenomenon known as rebates in the way that pharmacy benefit managers deal with pharmaceutical companies. I noted that ordinarily it was a crime to kick back money to a provider, for some reason that nobody could justify, there was an exclusion for these rebates by pharmacy benefit managers to pharmaceutical companies. So in the case of prescription drug pricing, rebates and discounts provided by manufacturers could mean the difference between a drug being covered by your insurance plan or not. And certainly, whatever the net price is after the rebate is not transparent to anybody, much less to the consumer, or returned directly to the consumer. So not only does this drive up the list price and out-of-pocket costs of life-saving drugs, it makes it impossible for Congress or anybody to determine where each dollar goes. I find this lack of transparency alarming. It shouldn't take an advanced degree to figure out where your money's going when you buy prescription drugs, or how to shop for the most effective drug at the right price. So when it comes to prescription drugs, we need to promote transparency first and foremost, and we need to streamline and eliminate regulations and laws that allow the middlemen to unnecessarily drive up prices. And we know we have the opportunity to do that in the coming months. We shouldn't require people suffering from chronic diseases to subsidize the health care costs of healthy people. There's something strangely wrong about this picture. So I'm glad we had the opportunity to listen to witnesses on this topic, and I thank them for taking the time to share their insights. I look forward to continuing to work with all of our colleagues on the Finance Committee and generally to identify ways to make prescription drugs more affordable and accessible to the American people. And as the presiding officer knows, given his background in healthcare, I'm confident he can be an important part of that solution as well. Mr. President, switching gears just a bit, I want to share a quick good news story of two outstanding Texans who've blazed the trail for women in public service. While I was in San Antonio, my hometown, a couple of weeks ago, I had the chance to congratulate our new U.S. Marshal for the Western District of Texas, Susan Pamerleau. Over the years, she's held many impressive titles: General in the Air Force, Sheriff, and now she's a United States Marshal. And in addition to each of those, I've always been proud to know her under a different title, as a friend. At Susan's ceremonial swearing-in, Chief Judge Orlando Garcia opened by noting the historical significance of her being the first female marshal ever in the Western District of Texas, which was established in 1857. Susan's long and impressive career began at Lackland Air Force Base in Texas, where my dad happened to have been stationed at one time, where she received her commission through Officers Training School. Over the course of a 32-year career in the Air Force, she rose through the ranks and retired ultimately as an Air Force Major General in the year 2000. When she returned to Texas, Susan joined USAA as a vice president and later became a senior vice president. It wasn't until 10 years later her career in law enforcement began when she was elected sheriff of Bexar County, Texas, which is the 11th largest sheriff office in the nation. She was the first woman to hold that role as well, but said that it wasn't about being the first woman. This was Susan talking. She said, it's really about redefining the role of what Bexar County Sheriff does. Over the years, I've had the opportunity to work with her on a number of issues impacting my constituents and our constituents, including mental health and law enforcement reforms, and I think she's made an enormous contribution to both of those areas. Needless to say, I was thrilled when the President nominated Susan to be the new U.S. Marshal for the Western District and when she was confirmed last fall. Her integrity, leadership, and management skills are critical to the Western District, which comprises 68 counties and more than 6 million people. So I'd like to once again congratulate my dear friend Susan Pamerleau on becoming the U.S. Marshal, and I look forward to continuing to work with her as we serve together the people of Texas. And finally, when you talk about women opening doors in Texas, you can't leave out Mary Lou Robinson, who sadly passed away last weekend at the age of 92. Her long and distinguished legal career began at the University of Texas Law School, where she met her husband, AJ. After law school, they returned to Amarillo, Texas, where they opened up the firm appropriately named Robinson & Robinson. In 1955, she left the private practice of law when Potter County Commissioners appointed her judge of the Potter County Court at Law, making her the first in a series of firsts for her, for this remarkable woman. Judge Robinson found her passion, and she was hooked. In the coming decade, she became an advocate for women's rights, and she helped promote the passage of the Texas Equal Rights Amendment, a constitutional amendment voted on by the people in 1972. Over the course of a remarkable 63-year judicial career, Judge Robinson served as the 108th District Court Judge, followed by Associate and then Chief Justice of the 7th Court of Appeals, located in Amarillo. In 1979, she was appointed by President Jimmy Carter to be Judge of the United States District Court for the Northern District of Texas, where she served for nearly 40 years. Her career is impressive, not only for its length, but for its quality. One attorney practicing before Judge Robinson noted, he said, lawyers may disagree on a lot of things, but most of us all agree that she treats everyone equally and fairly. That's high praise for a district judge. Judge Robinson will be remembered as an inspiring and devoted judge, an early advocate for women's rights, and a beloved member of her community. Last summer, Senator Cruz and I introduced a bill to rename the federal building and courthouse in Amarillo the Marvin Jones Federal Building and the Mary Lou Robinson United States Courthouse. This lasting testament to her judicial career will live on for generations, and I'm proud we were able, Senator Cruz and I, were able to cement this legacy for this legal pioneer. So while our family sends our prayers to the family of Mary Lou Robinson, we can all be proud of her distinguished career of service, not only in her beloved community in Amarillo, but to the state of Texas and to the nation as a whole. Mr. President, I yield the floor.